Hello guys, welcome once more to Class Online. My name is Tutor Dami, and in this edition we shall be looking at JAMB Physics 2014, question number 36 to 40, and we shall be eating it on the ground. Now don't forget that if you learn something from this video, click on the like button. We have more content to send to you that will better help you clarify JAMB Physics. Let's get to the video and to the questions now. Number 36, the maximum power transfer occurs in a cell when the external resistance is what? Now, is it like if you have a cell like a battery, right? The maximum power of the battery happens when? Is it when the external resistance is A, the same as the internal resistance, B, greater than the internal resistance of a cell, C, less than the internal resistance of a cell, D, twice the internal resistance of a cell? Do you have any idea? When does the battery have maximum power? That means when does the power flow most freely? Now, do you have any idea which one might be right? Now, if you don't, let's take a look at it now. Now, here I put down some point here. Power transfer between a voltage source and external load is at the most efficient when the resistance of the load match the internal resistance of the voltage source. So when the external resistance and the internal resistance are equal, the power will flow easily. Now, if the load resistance is too low, that is the internal, then most of the power output of the voltage source is dissipated as heat inside the source itself. Now, if the load resistance is too high, then the current which flows in the circuit is too low to transfer energy to the load at an appropriate rate. So now I want us to take note of some things. Now they say if the load resistance is too low, then the most of the power output of the voltage source is dissipated as heat. So if there is no load, that means if you have a circuit, like you have a bulb on a circuit, and the bulb is small, and there's much power in the circuit, but the bulb taking the power is too low. That means if you plug a tiny bulb to a circuit with much power, there is no much load in that circuit. Because why? The bulb is too small. So the load of the circuit is too low because the bulb you are putting on that power on that circuit is too low. Like if you put on a big gen for charging your phone, charging your phone is not heavy, but you are putting on a big system for a little load. And what will happen is that what the output of the voltage source is dissipated as heat inside the source itself. That means there will be a lot of waste. That means there will be an imbalance of power. So there are some gen that make a lot of noise when the load is too low. There will be instability. There will not be maximum power transfer in that system. But if the load resistance is too high, now that means that, let me say, if you put on a little gen, a small gen, like a tiger gen, and then you now put on refrigerator, and you put on your refrigerator, and you put on the what's it called, everything at home, and you put on all the heavy machines used at home on a tiny gen, what will happen? Right? Now what we have here, if the resistance load is too high, then the current which flows in the circuit is too low to transfer. There will be too much difficulty to transfer energy to the load at an appropriate rate because the resistance in the system is too high. The gen will be finding it difficult to send inward energy because they are not the mate of the gen. So the gen is like a small boy trying to feed the big men. So all the big men will feel like a small boy. You can't feed them. Come on. So the gen will suffer so much. Now that's it. But the maximum power transfer is when there's a balance between the load and the power source. And that is what we have here. So the question is, the maximum power transfer occur in the cell when the external resistance is equal, when the external resistance is the same as the internal resistance of a cell. Now when there's a balance between the power coming in and the load within, there will be maximum power, there will be free flow of power, and there will be maximum power transfer. And that is the answer for number 36. Now, number 37 says, if a metal wire 4 meters long and cross-sectional area 0.88 millimeter square, please, has a resistance of 6 ohm, find the resistivity of the wire. Now, when you get the word resistivity in physics, only one formula can handle it, and that formula is this: R equals EL over A, where my R is my resistance, my E is my resistivity, L is length, and A is area. This is the only formula that can handle anything resistivity in physics. Please take note. Now, I'm finding the resistivity, so I will solve for what resistivity, or make it because the subject of formula. So I'll just do plus multiply, EL will come down, then R will times A, that's RA. Then making E to stand alone, remove the L by dividing it. So the E will now become RA over L. So now plug in your value. What's your R? Your resistance is 6 ohm. That says my area is what? 0.88 millimeter. Now, but you must change to meter. It must not be in millimeter. And how do you change to meter from millimeter? Dividing it by 1,000, which is the same thing as 10 raised to the power minus 3, because the amount is there because it is division. And 1,000 makes it 3 because there are 3 zeros in 1,000. So I have 0.88 times 10 to the power minus 3. Okay, all squared, okay, because millimeter, because it is area, it has to be squared. Then over length, the length is 4 meter, and that's just 4. So now I'll solve it now. Then, so the square will come on the 0.88 times 10 to the power minus 3 times square is 10 to the power minus 6, that's 3 times 2. So I have 6 times 0.88 squared times 10 to the power minus 6 all over 4. And if I solve for that, that will be giving me 6 is 6. 0.88 squared is 0.8 times 10 to the power minus 6 over 4. If you multiply all the up, multiply 6 times 0.8, numbers only. Don't multiply the 10 to the power minus 6. Multiply only the number. 6 times 0.8 divided by 4 will give you 1.2 times 10 to the power minus 6 ohms meter. And that is the answer for your resistivity. Don't forget the formula. R equals EL over A, where E is my resistivity, and that is the answer to that question. Let's get to it. A circuit has a resistance of 200 ohms. Okay, the resistance of a circuit can be reduced to 120 ohm. How can you reduce the resistance of a circuit? Do you have any idea? Now, actually, we have A is a 80 ohm resistor is connected to it in series. B, a 150 ohm resistor is connected to it in parallel. C, a 240 ohm resistor is connected to it in series. D, a 300 ohm resistor is connected to it in parallel. Now, do you have any idea which one might be right? It's very simple. Now, when you hear the word reducing resistance, resistance only gets reduced in parallel connection. Since connections increase resistances, only parallel connections reduce resistances. So that means all the options we see are wrong. A is wrong. I know that from the beginning that A is wrong and B is wrong, because only connections in parallel reduce. And you will know that from the formula of what resistance in parallel and in series. You have to plus resistance 1 plus resistance 2. And when you are plusing, it's getting bigger. So series connections increase. They can't reduce. But for parallel connection, you have to do the inverse of the word of the plusing, that over R to tau equals 1 over the first one plus 1 over the second one, which will what reduce the resistance. So now that will now bring us to this place. Now, so we have a circuit has a resistance of 200 ohms. The resistance of circuit can be reduced to 120 ohms when it has to be in parallel. So the two parallels are what I work on here. Supposed to be in series, this is supposed to be in parallel. Sorry. This is supposed to be parallel resistance. It should be 1 over R to tau. So I just focus on the two parallel. This is the first parallel and this is the second parallel. Which of these two parallel will give me an answer of 120? So working with the first parallel, I have 1 over R to tau, because parallel connections are always 1 over. 1 over R to tau equals 1 over 200 plus 1 over 150. What is the 200? The 200 is this one. It's the one in the question. And the 150 came from the option. I'm looking at which option will give me a final answer of 120. So I'm working with 1 over 200 plus 1 over 150. If you solve that further,
The LCM of 200 and 150 is 600. So 200 divided by 600 is 3. Then 150 and 600 is 4. 3 plus 4 is 7 over 600. If you cross multiply, you'll be getting 600 over 7. That's my R total. I inverted it. Okay, that's my R total. That, and that will give you 85.7. That will not give you 120. So the first one, that's the option B, is wrong. It won't give you 120. I have 1 over 200 plus 1 over 300 giving me 600 as my LCM. 200 and 600 is 3. 3 plus 300 and 600 is 2. That's 5 over 600. If you invert it, that will become 600 over 5, give me 120. And that means that the answer that will give me 120 ohms by reduction is the option D. And that makes option D the correct answer to that question. Number 39, PHCN. Do you know what that means? Everybody should know what that means, right? Everybody in Nigeria knows what PHCN is. And most people don't like them, but it doesn't matter. We know what they mean, what it means. PHCN means what? Power Holding Company of Nigeria, which was formerly NEPA. Okay, now the Power Holding Company of Nigeria measures its electrical energy in what? Now, on your meter, the energy that you have burned is measured in what? Is it kilowatt hour or kilowatt or watt hour or joule or watt? Now, you should not be deceived to say that the energy is measured in joule, although it is energy, but NEPA does measure their energy in joule. So it is not in joule. So it is actually now this is the NEPA guy. I just kept him here. The answer to that question is actually what you will need to check your bill for. On your bill, power is always measured in kilowatt hour, and kilo is 1,000, the watt that you have used times 1,000. Okay, the watt you have used times 1,000. That means the amount of power you have used times 1,000, and that is just it. That is just it. That is the amount of power you have used times 1,000. Okay, then the hour is the amount of time you have you spent using that power, and that is it. So then the total energy is going to be what? Kilowatt hour. And that is just the answer to that question. So it is a function of the amount of power that you burn, and the amount of, although kilowatt is the word watt is power, it's not even energy. The word watt is power, but I power, that's power times 1,000. Okay, then times the amount of time that you spend using it. So I can have Mrs. Bola use 20,000 kilowatts in within what 280,000 hours. That is how they calculate it, and that's the way they do it and bring it to what on the bill. So the answer is kilowatt hour. Number 40, the last one for this video. What is the best method of demagnetizing a steel bar magnet? Now, this magnet, now how can you remove magnetism from a magnet? Let's just make it general. How can you, what's the best? Now there are many methods of demagnetizing or magnetizing a magnet. One of them is what? Electrical method. Another one is what? Electrical method. Another one is by stroking. Another one is by induction. Now, but the best method is not even by heating. It's the best method is this method. Yeah, it's by electricity. And that method is called solenoid method. Now, solenoid is when you put a metal in between coil of electricity. That metal will become charged, okay? And if it is just an ordinary conductor wrapped by a coil, it will begin to spin, okay? Because a magnetic field will be produced around the metal. What I mean is that if you have a metal like this and you wind wires around it and you send electricity through that wire, the metal will become magnetic. It will become charged. And when metal is charged, it gains magnetic properties. And that is the best method to make or to destroy a magnet. But you know, magnets are always suspended in the north and south direction, not south direction. But if you want to magnetize it, put it in the north-south direction. But if you want to remove the magnetism, put it in the south-north direction. What I mean is that if you want to demagnetize the magnet, put it in this if you want to magnetize the magnet, put it in the north-south direction and run
current through it. But if you want to demagnetize, put it in the east-west direction and run current through it. Now, magnet hates its east-west direction. Magnets only like north-south direction. So if you put a magnet in the east-west, it will lose its magnetism. It will lose its power. So because magnets don't like them, they don't like east-west direction. They like they like north-south. So if you suspend a magnet freely, it will naturally on its own stay in the north-south direction. But if you put it in the east-west, it will get weak. So if one of the demagnetize, send current through it, that is called a solenoid. But put it also in the east-west direction, it will perish. It will lose the magnetism and it will become an ordinary metal. And that is how the best method is by a solenoid method. And that's the answer for number 14. And that brings us to the end of this video. Don't forget, if you learned something from this video and you want to get more content from us that will better help you understand things, click on the like button and we'll get to reach you with what will help you better destroy things. Until you see again, guys, take care of yourself and bye for now.